So first, I think I should thank the organizers again for inviting me, and thank you guys for getting up so early. It added to the effect that it was raining at 7 a.m. this morning. So so I was wondering if there's going to be about me and four of my friends here, Meg and Ruth, and, but I'm glad to see everybody is here. So what I was asked to talk about was strength training for people with Parkinson's disease. What is the evidence? That was the title that was provided. So I'm going to interpret that term evidence a little bit for you. But first, before going on, I want to acknowledge in the work that we've done, the participants, the movement disorders team that I'm fortunate to work with, including physical therapists, as well as neurosurgeons and neurologists, and then also the funding agencies that have provided funding for some of our work. So I could utilize the that pyramid over there, kind of hierarchical levels of evidence, just put up some forest plots of meta-analyses today. But I didn't want to go and just do that, talk about randomized controlled trials, because I don't think that gives you the full picture of what the research that has been done on resistance training in Parkinson's disease. So this is kind of the way I interpreted the charge I was given. What is the physiologic evidence? And I was going to address a number of questions. Why resistance training? Why have we chosen to look at it from a research standpoint? And why should you consider it for a treatment modality? If you're considering using resistance training, is there weakness associated with normal aging? And is there weakness associated with Parkinson's disease? And then within the context of central nervous system deficits, there has been a historical concern that resistance training may not be safe. So is resistance training safe? If you use it, it is safe. Will it actually do what you want? Will it have the desired physiologic effect? Will it increase force production? Something that we're most concerned with in regards to prescribing exercise in general for people with Parkinson's disease is that will it improve mobility? Will it reduce disease severity? That would be one of those things that we'd really like to have, is if it could reduce UPDRS scores. And an additional question I have, we spent time looking at the lower extremities and their response to resistance training, but if resistance training as an intervention has benefit, it should cut across different skeletal muscle groups. It shouldn't have to be the lower extremities. It could be the upper extremities. It could be accessory muscles of respiration or pelvic floor muscles. And then lastly, are there any hints at mechanism from our work or combinations of our work and others that are doing research in the field? So first I wanted to give you what our perspective has been of the term hypokinesia, that reduced movement amplitude and reduced movement speed, that most of the individuals that we're seeing have Parkinson's disease, plus they have some advanced age. So as a product of age and inactivity, they may have weakness or loss of muscle mass. And then Parkinson's disease, given its effect on particular areas within the central nervous system, also adds to that. The additive effect of both the sedentary behavior and age, as well as the central nervous system problem, creates consequences of hypokinesia. Right? And I'm going to specify that that's occurring not only in the axial skeleton, midline of the body, but also in an appendicular standpoint. So the first thing that I said I was going to cover was, is there weakness in aging? If you haven't read these references here on the page, I would refer you to these because they're interesting kind of summaries from the Journal of Gerontology by Manini and Clark. The 2008 is the first paper, and then they updated it in January 2012. And they're talking about the fact that sarcopenia, loss of sarcomeres, is epidemic in normal aging. But then they go on to coin another term, dynapenia, or the loss of muscle force. And that actually exceeds what you would expect from just the loss of muscle mass. So it's not just mass, it's the neurologic contributions to force production that that also are affected. It seems to be amplified in weight-bearing muscles, and as I said earlier, inactivity plays a particular role in that loss. So there appears to be weakness that occurs in the context of aging. What about in the context of Parkinson's disease? Those studies that have looked at resistance training, or I'm sorry, just weakness in people with PD, have found it in multiple muscle groups, the quadriceps, the hamstrings, the plantar flexors, the dorsiflexors. They found it at different contraction velocities and different contraction types. That's on the, in the appendicular skeleton. But if you look and take a little bit broader definition of weakness, you may see it in respiratory muscles as a result of pulmonary function tests. You may see it in swallowing, laryngeal muscles, as a result of looking at swallowing studies. And you may actually see it in pelvic floor musculature. Okay, so what I want to do now is kind of step through what I was talking about in terms of the physiologic evidence. One of the first questions that I asked was, is resistance training safe? So in 2004 and 2005, we ended up undertaking a resistance training study where we utilized eccentric resistance training, which traditionally had been seen as a muscle damage paradigm. So one of the things that we had to fight against was the belief that we were going to damage the muscle and do something bad to the patients. So we drew blood from these patients at three time points during the training program. I'm sorry, four time points during the training program. And then also took muscle pain scores. And these are the results from that. And just to kind of give you a sense, serum CK values are on the left-hand side here, with that dotted line being the accepted cutoff for what we'd consider to be concentrations of CK that would indicate muscle damage. Visual analog pain scores here on the other side, you can see that the visual analog pain scores increased. That was a delayed onset muscle soreness event, but then declined and stayed close to zero. And then the CK values, again, corresponding with the delayed onset muscle soreness, rose to close to 150, but never exceeded that muscle damage threshold. So we took that as evidence that, that we were not damaging the muscle in a way that would adversely affect the patients. So rather than put up just slides from our own work, I went ahead and tried to gather work from a variety of researchers that are doing this. This is actually from poster 449. Serene Paul, who's in the audience, is the author on this poster, and it's Colleen Canning's group at the University of Sydney. This is a power training study, and Serene was kind enough to provide me the poster. Thank you. And I selected out one table from that poster. I just wanted to draw your attention to... The values here, let's just look at leg extensor for muscle power. Pre-training, the experimental group 388, 456 post, and if you went down in those boxes, you'd see that there was a consistent increase in muscle power, which is the strength divided by the time. There was also increases in muscle strength. And those are consistent results with the other with other studies that have bothered to look at this. They this group has chosen to look at muscle power, and we can talk about why that might be a nice measure from a clinical and training standpoint, if you'd like later. So it does appear to increase muscle force. What is the benefit of increasing muscle force? I'll show you a slide from Daniel Korkos's group in Chicago, and this is a recent paper that was published within the Movement Disorders Journal just this year. And on the y-axis here, it's the mean change in the UPDRS score off medication. So they use the baseline that, at the start of the study as the zero point. So everything is reflected on that. And so anything that goes below zero reflects an improvement in the motor UPDRS. And you can see from 0 to 6 months, both the progressive resistance training group in red and this what they call fitness counts, which is a kind of active control group in black, they both declined what would appear to be a greater than a clinically important difference in the UPDRS score, but only after over the 24 months did the resistance training group persist with that improvement in the off-medication UPDRS score. This is data over here from our own work, kind of represented in the same way. Baseline off-medication is represented as zero. So medication has an improvement in balance with this. This is the functional gait assessment. Off medication post-training, there is an improvement relative to off medication pre-training, and then the collaborative effect of medication and resistance training appears to have the most benefit. So these patients were tested at the end on medication after the training, and we're trying to show that there's a combined beneficial effect of medication and the exercise on these persons' function. So, as I said, our work has focused on limb training, especially the lower extremities. But I think that's a narrow view of the potential benefits of resistance training. So I wanted to provide examples from two other people's work that look at different skeletal muscle systems. And in this case, this is from Christine Sapienza at the University of Florida. And they've done what they call expiratory muscle strength training. They're using a high-tech, I've used a high-tech kazoo that resists the individual's ability to breathe out. So they have they can breathe out against the smaller aperture. They have to generate enough pressure to open the aperture and be able to breathe out. So effectively, it's somewhat like an isometric resistance training paradigm for their accessory muscles of respiration. These graphs represent airflow in liters per second. And then that's the inspiratory and cough kind of mechanics. What you're looking for, this is the compression phase duration where the person has finished inspiration and is getting ready to expire. And what you want to see is a reduction in that. That would be more effective. And this is pre-training, post-training. You can see a reduction in the compression phase duration. And then you also want to be able to accelerate the volume of air out of the lungs to move whatever's in the lungs out. So you'd like this to be a narrower band, this expiratory rise time. You'd like it to be more steep and less duration. And that occurred post-training for all the individuals. So this is a small study. This is not a randomized clinical trial. There's 10 subjects that underwent training. But you can see that not only did they get better with the airflow dynamics for cough, but in other studies they've looked at, there appears to be some improvements in laryngeal mechanics and maybe some decrease in aspiration risk. So I struggled with what to do at the 7 a.m. meeting here that, okay, I want to do pelvic floor. I'm like, okay, it might be a little bit early for anatomic pictures of the pelvic floor. So I chose to try to get some relatively benign pictures. So this is an article that was published in Neurology by Vaughn, looking at VA patients in the United States. And what they ended up doing was biofeedback treatment for urinary incontinence, males and females. But they used EMG biofeedback. And they showed dramatic reductions in the episodes of incontinence for these individuals, in some cases on the order of 80% reduction in incontinence episodes. So yes, behaviorally that's important for that person, but I also think extrapolating that it may have some relevance in terms of the fall risk that these individuals may have, because certainly in non-Parkinsonian individuals, urinary incontinence by itself ends up being a risk factor for falls. So. This was effectively an isometric exercise also because they're contracting. The home exercise program that these individuals were doing was a Kegel-type exercise. So it's not a dynamic contraction. So I've talked to you about safety. I've talked to you about the efficacy in terms of disease severity, increases in force production, and cutting across different skeletal muscle groups. But how does it work? I mean, what's the mechanism by which it works? So in our 2006 study, we ended up looking at people with more mild Parkinson's disease and looked at saw force improvements, but we chose to use an anatomic outcome measure. We took MRI scans of these individuals' thighs and quantified the lean muscle mass via the MRI scan, and we were able to show that these individuals retained the ability to hypertrophy the skeletal muscle. I think as physios, I can say that I felt like I knew that would happen, but we were able to use the expensive tools to figure out that it actually does. We followed that up. Most recently, we have a paper in review right now where we had more moderately affected patients, and interestingly, the results were different. This time, we got force improvements, just like we did on the previous go-around, but this time there was no hypertrophy. as a group. There are some individuals that were able to hypertrophy, but as a group, the individuals did not hypertrophy. So thinking back to muscle physiology, that would likely indict a potential neural recruitment factor that might have improved. Unfortunately, we did not have that as an outcome measure in our study. So I needed to go to other individuals, Daniel Korkos' group in Chicago. They don't use an anatomic measure, but they use EMG as one of their outcome measures. And on the y-axis here is the first agonist EMG normalized to time, so the big burst that might occur at the start of the recruitment. And you can see that as time goes on, over the 24 months of training, the progressive resistance training group shows an improvement that is not provided at all by the fitness counts group. So these individuals got better at recruiting the electrical activity of their muscle as a result of the resistance training. And most interesting to me is that they can sustain that improvement over the 24 months. So that combination of the anatomic measures showing a lack of hypertrophy in these more moderately affected patients, coupled with these electrical measures from the Korkos group, which suggests that we're at least in the moderately impaired patients, improving neural recruitment of the muscle. Ideally, we'll have a study in the future that actually uses both outcome measures together and gets a little bit more tangible documentation of that. Whoa. Let's go back. See if I can go back one. Okay. So clinical implementation. Are you guys using this within clinical practice at this time? Are you doing resistance training? Okay. Serene shaking her head. I think I knew that you were going to be. But my recommendation would be that you don't think of it as just a mobility-related factor, that you have the ability to utilize resistance training in a variety of skeletal muscle groups for some benefits that you might not have thought of before you came. Cough, gait and balance, continence. I wish I could tell you what the mode of contraction would be best. I think you probably need to look at task specificity and what type of contractions does that person need to use for their particular tasks that they're doing in everyday life and train that, because that will probably be the best response. My bias from reading the literature is that you need to focus on the intensity of the contraction. That doesn't necessarily mean 80% of one repetition max. That may need to be speed, may need to be focused on power. But if you critically read some of the other trials on exercise that have gone, that have been published recently, and they show a less than robust resistance training response, and you look at what they've done very minimal loading of the muscle. So it's unrealistic to expect you're going to get dramatic force increases if you only provide resistance that's 1% of the body weight. You need to load the muscle and force it to work. Our training trial was 2 times per week, so was the Korkos trial. On the other end of the spectrum, the cough study and the urinary incontinence study were every day. So from a frequency standpoint, I think you need to try to decide what works best for your patient. I think the minimum dosage you should consider would be 2 to 3 times per week. Duration. We've done a 12-week duration. Other studies have also done that. But as you saw from the Korkos et al. Trial, they had the patients working for 24 months. So as long as you can maintain the motivation of the participants. So kind of lastly, from a clinical implementation standpoint, I think generally if you look at clinical practice, and this is not evidence-based in the sense that I have documentation from a journal article, but underdosing is the standard of care. A question I often ask individuals when I'm talking to them is, how often, if you're providing resistance training for your person with Parkinson's disease, do you make that person have a delayed onset muscle soreness event? Typically, there's a kind of a quietness after that question. In most cases, I think people do not. But I would say that is a necessary measure to say that you actually have stimulated the muscle enough to provoke it to increase its strength. Okay. The optimal mode and intensity is unclear. You should be focusing on appendicular and axial musculature. And then I put an asterisk by the bottom bullet. That's an interpretation of multiple studies, not only our own, but that disease severity may limit the response. as the central nervous system degradation proceeds, there may be a continued or advancing under-recruitment of the motor cortex and the cortical spinal tract and its contributions to force production. But that does remain, it does appear that that remains malleable to some training. How much remains to be seen. And that was earlier this year here at the Sydney Opera House. I've been fortunate over the last 6 months to be living here, working with Colleen and Serene, Natalie, and the other people at the University of Sydney. So one of the things I put up on the acknowledgement slide was also I should acknowledge the University of Sydney for the hospitality and the ability to work here and have an endless summer for this entire year. So, so are there questions that people have? When? Yes. So Lynn's question was that you have, and I'll paraphrase, correct me if I'm wrong, that you have individuals that you might be treating that have worry about how much they should be able to exercise, and you also have clinicians that are worried about overtaxing their patients. And we've done some work to show that it appears to be safe and feasible, but that word hasn't necessarily got out to the masses, to the patients or to the providers. And Lynn's question was, how do we get that information out to those individuals? I think I'm happy to see that there have been some meta-analyses recently that continue to support the effect of resistance training in people with Parkinson's disease. And I think one of the things we haven't focused on enough, at least in the literature, is making sure that we're documenting that there haven't been adverse events within the studies. Because besides just a safety and efficacy study showing kind of blood chemistry, I think it would be more convincing for some clinicians to see in a paper that say that one of the first lines of the results is that there were no adverse events, there were no musculoskeletal injuries that occurred as a result of the training. I mean, that's just one thing that comes to mind right now. Certainly. And to put your message with the comorbidity with a specific patient would probably make us think, how can we pass the message? Right, and I'm fairly sure that if you look at the inclusion criteria, I can speak for my own studies, but also likely for Colleen and Serene's and other studies, that we all have patients that have those comorbidities. We have certainly drop dead, that was a bad pun, sorry. Absolute contraindications to exercise, but there are a number of them that are that have hypertension, that have osteoarthritis, and in fact I would argue that most of them do, so that people are being able to participate in that exercise with those comorbidities. Serene, you know? Yeah.
I know for our study, we didn't exclude those sorts of conditions. So we had people with hip replacements, knee replacements, and so forth that could participate. I was just going to make a comment in that at our uni, we work, one of the professors, Maria Fiatoroni-Singh, is a geriatrician who does a lot of research on high-intensity strength training and power training in the older population across different medical conditions as well as in very old. So people in their 80s, in their 90s in nursing homes. And so that literature that has been around since the 90s and the early 2000s have consistently shown that these older populations can actually safely improve muscle mass, improve strength, improve function through high-intensity strength training. And she puts them through loads that are very high, so 80, 90% of their maximal loads, and they train 3 times a week. And that's been quite a consistent effect that's also been replicated in some of the Finnish literature as well.
So the question is, for the younger onset patient that might be a little bit overzealous in their resistance training to begin with, what would be the guidance? So from a CK value, what's been accepted in the literature that, that I'm familiar with is that 200, I'm drawing a blank on the units right now. But what we've chosen to do, especially with the eccentric paradigm, is titrate the load, is purposely try to have a 3 to 4 week ramp up period where we're gradually increasing the load. So we don't throw the resistance at them on day one and go from no activity or no resistance training exposure to a therapeutic dose that they're going to exercise at for the next 3 or 4 months. So we're trying to really kind of titrate that load, and that would be my best recommendation. I'd have to look back at the literature to tell you, okay, if you're drawing CK values, this is something that you need to tell them to back off and stop. No. Right. 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 Okay. I need to step away now. And
thank you.